So the other thing that's going on here is that this is going to be an intro to using tools in Arc Toolbox from Arc Catalog. So Arc Catalog is one program within ArcGIS, which is kind of a suite of programs. Arc Toolbox is another program, but really Arc Toolbox is a collection of mini programs, each program being a tool. So here's how it works. If you go into our catalog and you go up to this red toolbox in front of the Facebook page and click on it, you should get this panel called Arc Toolbox that pops into your screen here. And you'll notice that as soon as you touch it and start to move it, there are these like all points of like there's these little blue pointers that pop up, and these little blue pointers are docking stations. So if I'm clicking this and holding it and dragging it, and I go over to this docking station, it'll line up so that I can now get that panel kind of docked over there. You'll also notice that there's a little thumbtack here, auto hide. So if I uncheck that, it kind of collapses and goes into this space, and then if I click on it or hover over it, it pops back up and it lets me access it. But then as soon as I do something else over here, it should automatically go away. So what you're going to find is ArcGIS is a big kind of real estate hog, and so this was a design decision to kind of keep it from, to kind of free up some monitor space. You'll notice though that once you have that pin kind of on, when it becomes lazy and it's on its side, it's I think hard to undock this thing. So in order, if you wanted to move it someplace else, you have to first pin it, and then you can move it anywhere you'd like. I tend to keep it over here on the right side. That's just where it likes to live for me. And then what you're going to notice is that within Arc Toolbox there are a bunch of toolboxes, and then when you click on a toolbox, they're full of trays. Each tray has a hammer, and when you open up a tray, it's full of hammers, and when you open up another tray, it's full of hammers. So the hammer icon here just means it's a tool, which means it's a script or a program that's been written to do something. And what we're going to do, what we're about to do is to find the hammer that converts this guy into a new raster format. It can be hard to, the organization of this thing will probably make sense to you over time, but when you're first coming into GIS, this is kind of basically the way these kind of experts and engineers have decided to organize their tools. And to you coming in, this kind of organization scheme probably doesn't make a whole lot of sense. So fortunately, there's this other kind of blue marble in front of a Facebook page. Then if you click on that, it's the search panel, and you can set this up where it looks like for me it automatically docked over there. It might come in like this, and you can again kind of dock it. And this is going to be pretty handy because it's going to allow you to search within this framework for the tool that you want. And let's just kind of type in what my what did I do? Did we use the word convert text to raster? What if we type in that, and what you'll see is that it finds these two tools, and then it says up in parentheses, it says a word after it, and that parentheses is telling you that this tool lives here in conversion. So if I went into conversion, you'll see, oh, okay, we're looking for a tool. ASCII is basically a text file. ASCII is a format for, it's a byte format for storing characters. Anyways, this is just meaning it's a text file, and so it converts a text file into a raster, which is what we want. It's called ASCII to raster. It's in the conversion, and lo and behold, if we looked under to raster, there it is, ASCII to raster, and here are a bunch of other tools that have a similar function. And so right, because these are all different formats that you can convert into a raster format. Okay, sorry for all the detail. Sometimes I kind of feel like the typewriter expert from the movie The Lives of Others, but let's keep moving then. On task here. So we're going to use this ASCII to raster conversion tool, and I'm going to click once on that, and this GUI is going to pop up. And it's not because this thing is particularly sticky, but GUI just means graphical user interface, so I'm just going to be calling these things GUIs. This one is relatively straightforward. All we need to tell it is what goes in and what goes out, and then and then there's one parameter on the things that goes out. So let's start with the easy part, which is what goes in. We want this guy to go in here. So all we need to do is click on this, and then hopefully if you have to, you can navigate to lab one, my first raster, open. And then what's nice is that it automatically figured out that we're gonna put the output file in this lab one GDB, which is, I think, something that it's because we set our environments previously. I don't particularly like the name that it gave as a default. I'm going to change that, because what I'd like to do is use a naming convention so that the names of my files as they appear in the list here, they appear in the order that I made them. That makes it easier for me to keep track of things. So I'm going to go in here, and it's going to bring me into lab one. And my convention is usually just, I don't think you can begin with a number. So instead of beginning with a number, I'm going to begin with lowercase o. So Othello 1, and then this is my, and then this is another bit I do. So I use the underscore. So this is, if you go up, I think it's the character next to the 0. If you hold the shift down, you'll get one of those, right? And so this is my first raster underscore from text. And if you really, right, that helps you read it and helps space out the words without using spaces. Save, and then the output data type is basically asking you, okay, you have these numbers here, what data type do you want the computer to store those numbers? So let's just put this into our kind of memory here that we're going to have to talk about data types and what the difference is between an integer and a float. For now, let's just say that integer is actually the best choice that we could do. So we're going to say OK. And it's going to try to run, and it ran into an error. And hopefully it didn't run into an error for you, but I kind of purposely made an error in my file just in case you got one. And I wanted you also, everyone, to see what getting an error looks like. Not that it will probably, because this will probably happen to you. So you're going to get this kind of red error message with something that you can click on, and then this is the kind of explanation you get. There was a problem. Check the syntax of the function, and this is stuff that it's actually kind of hard to troubleshoot that, but that's the information that you have to go on. So to troubleshoot this, I'm going to say, well, I think it has something to do with this guy, with my first raster. And so I'm going to go back, and I have a feeling it has to do with something I did here. So if I go in, and notice that I'm opening this guy up in a Windows, what are these things called? Windows Explorers, basically, this guy. And if I double click, it should open automatically in Notepad. And do you see what the problem is? Yeah, I didn't fill out the cell size. So I'm going to fix that. But this problem could be that you have it like that. You might have a number here, but you might not have a line kind of break in between this and that. Make sure that cell size is one word, like all of this little stuff. There's no spaces at the end of these numbers, you know. I'm giving away a couple things here, but no big deal. Like cell size, I still wanted you to figure out. So let me just go over here and pause the recording. Okay, I just fixed that, and so now that should still. I might just repoint to it so that it loads up the saved file, and yep, that's what I want, and that's what I want. And so now if I say okay, it should clink through it. Took a 1.72 seconds. It's pretty funny that it reports it down to that level, but that's cool. That's definitely a computer talking to you, because no person would tell you that. And it's completed. And now what you can do is, if you highlight it here and go over to preview, you can take a look out of it. Now your colors might be different, and that's not important. But you'll have two views, basically. You have the geography view, and then you could say the table. And so what this is saying is that the value 0, don't worry about these so much, but the value 0 occurs 275 times for me, and the value 1 occurred 25 times. And these numbers may be different. It's totally fine if they are, but I just want you to know what they represent. And what those are representing are the numbers that you put in here. So for me, I put in 275 zeros across this whole raster, and I put in only, what was it, 25 ones. Okay? So congratulations, you made the first raster. Let's just kind of say, okay, what do we have? Anything to kind of keep in mind here, a naming convention? So let's see, there's the difference between search and toolbox. There was all of this kind of docking business and pins. Each tool has a kind of a GUI, and the GUI is going to be basically the input, the output, and some parameters. We found that you can, when we went into our catalog, you can preview, so that was kind of handy. And we found that you can preview both the geography, which means the kind of visual image, and the attributes, or I think that's what they call the table, right? Which are basically the attributes of this geography and some metadata about them. Like the idea of, ooh, should I write metadata down? Data about data. Should we end it on that note? I'm going to hit save.